Hey there, cousin here, and welcome back to Always Doing. When I asked for some ideas for videos, Anne suggested that I talk about my favorite medical nonfiction, and I cannot believe this is a video that I haven't made yet. So I'm fixing that now. Today I'm bringing you five of my favorite medical nonfiction books. They cover both the patient experience and the doctor's experience, from life through death, and I hope you like it. If you don't know, I am a medical interpreter. I work at hospitals here in Japan helping English-speaking patients communicate with their Japanese-speaking doctors, nurses, hospital staff of all sorts. So while I did not go to medical school, I am in the clinical environment quite a bit. And it has to have affected the kind of medical nonfiction I like. I'm going to go through these books in a kind of order. I'm starting with the ones that deal most with life, ending with the one that deals most with death, and that last book is actually my favorite of the entire bunch. So let's get into it. First is Invisible: How Young Women with Serious Health Issues Navigate Work Relationships and the Pressure to Seem Just Fine by Michelle Lenthirsch. This book centers young women who have serious medical stuff going on, whether it be endometriosis or major health problems of almost any sort, and how they're dealing with it because they are told, oh, you're too young to be sick. You're too pretty. You don't look like you're sick, when they are actually struggling with some really real stuff. And it's not just the people in their life. I mean, there's the whole relationships that's alluded to in the title, but also the medical community in general. In general, they have a hard time believing women's pain. So it goes over that, it goes over dating, and what I like about this book is, first of all, its own voices. Hirsch herself has chronic medical issues, including she needed hip surgery when she was in her 20s, walking around with a crutch and then a cane, telling people to give her a seat on the bus and them not believing her because she doesn't look sick. And she's also queer, and this is probably my favorite dimension of this book, is that it is intensely intersectional. Not only are we talking about white women who happen to have medical issues, but also people of color, queer folks. The author is also queer. And like the dimension of relationships, because she has had relationships with men and women, and she finds that in her heterosexual relationships, the guys not very good at dealing with her illness. And you hear about famous politicians and things that when their wife gets sick or gets cancer or whatever, they split and they divorce just like that. Where in her experience and in the experience of other people that she talks with, queer relationships tend to be much more understanding and open about the whole medical thing. I love that she talks to people about their own experience and that she lets them speak their truth on the page. They are quoted at length. It's done in an interesting way, never gets long or feels tedious. And I couldn't help but think that if this book were written by a white dude, a cisgender dude, a heterosexual dude, he probably would have grabbed like one or two of the juiciest quotes and glossed over the rest in his own words, where she lets people speak their truth on the page. I link the Goodreads pages for all these books down below, and do friend me or follow me if you're more comfortable with that on Goodreads, because that means my reviews will pop closer to the top in the friends reviews section. Because in my review of this, I link to a own voices review of someone who is queer and disabled themselves and their experience reading this book, which I found very valuable. They said it was the first book of this type that they found that wasn't centered on being queer, that saw them, and the intersectionality really meant a lot to them. If you'd like to know more about the lived experience about having all different kinds of health issues, this is a wonderful place to start. Next, we have Complications: A Surgeon's Notes on an Imperfect Science by Atul Gawande. Gawande is probably most well known for his book Being Mortal. I've read all of his books except for Being Mortal, and out of the rest of them, this is my favorite. Well, from the outside, we like to think of doctors as the people who know what is wrong with you and know what is going on and are able to fix you unerringly. That's not always the case. There's lots of issues of uncertainty, of less than perfect information, of doctors going on a hunch and hoping that they're correct. And how do you teach that? And how do you deal with that? Especially when you're like a surgeon and your job is to like cut the thing that's being a problem out of people. It's a little bit oh, that's pretty final. Gawande is an amazing writer. It is gripping and interesting. I actually did this as a buddy read with Heidi over at My Reading Life. And we split the book up into sections, like each week we'd read this one big section. I left that section until the day before, because I knew that once I started reading, I wouldn't be able to stop. This is a book that you can blow through. Even though the essays were previously published in different places, it doesn't get repetitive like it sometimes does when you put all those together. It flows quite well. You learn about his medical education, some, oh boy, cases of things that happen, including flesh-eating bacteria, those kind of things. And I have to say, for all of these books, obviously these are medical books, expect to rub up against things like death and nasty illnesses and things. If you are looking to get into medical nonfiction, this is a great place to start. His writing is wonderful because it's essays. He's talking about all different kinds of things, even within this main idea of uncertainty and complications. And it's a place to start. And then from here, you can go on to Being Mortal or any of his other works. One of my favorite doctor authors of all time is Danielle Offrey. I could have put several of her books on this list. She has books about patient-doctor communication, where it can go wrong, where it can go right. She has a book about how a doctor's emotions affect the job they do. She's has some more memoir-type books that I haven't gotten to yet, but her most recent release is my favorite of hers by far. It is When We Do Harm, A Doctor Confronts Medical Error. Medical error is something that nobody likes to think about. We don't want to think about it happening to us, and if you're in the medical profession, you really don't want to think about being part of an error and having created harm towards somebody else. I mean, first do no harm, right? So this is a touchy subject, but she dives right in. And I just spoke about Atul Gawande. He has a book called The Checklist Manifesto that has been very influential in medicine about getting rid of procedural error. So when you do something, like you insert a needle and then you do this thing, you make a checklist and that helps it go more smoothly with fewer errors. However, and Offrey touches on that, but a lot of what she talks about are the other kinds of errors that can come up and are much harder to prevent. For example, diagnostic error. So you go into the doctor with a collection of symptoms, you say, I have XYZ, and they say, oh, you have this. And the way their reasoning works, they could be right, but every once in a while they get it wrong. Why do they get it wrong? What kind of errors come out? How can you prevent errors in ways of thinking? It's so hard. And Offrey is an internal medicine doctor in New York City. She brings her own experience to this. She brings all kinds of research. Everything is endnoted. She also brings the experience of patients and their families, people who have had medical errors happen to them. She does a narrative nonfiction style talking about those errors. This sounds kind of dire, I know, but at the very end, she talks about what you can do as a patient to help prevent medical error, things to look out for, as well as lists of websites and organizations and people to get in contact with. If heaven forbid you are part of a medical error, this is incredible. I actually did a full video review of this book. If you would like to hear more about it, I will link it both up here and down below. We're getting closer and closer to death as we go through these. Next is Extreme Measures, Finding a Better Path to the End of Life by Jessica Nuttick Zitter. I find Zitter unique as a doctor because she started off as an ICU doctor, and her entire job there is to keep people alive, to do extreme measures in order to keep them alive. That's her whole point. Like, if a patient dies on you, that's a failure. It's never a good thing when you're in the ICU. She, after that, got certification in palliative care. And palliative care is helping people reach the end of their life in the manner they would like. So if somebody would rather be in hospice, if somebody wants to avoid the ICU altogether, maybe they don't. Maybe they want heroic measures done, and that's fine too, but it's setting expectations for the patient, for the family, and helping them navigate the medical system and staying out of it when possible. She does a lot talking about this conveyor belt at end-of-life care, and that when you put somebody on a respirator, it starts a pathway that's very hard to get off of. That once you start this conveyor belt to a medicalized death, it's hard to reach anything else. And she practices both. At her hospital, she spends some days in the ICU and some days doing palliative care. And being able to see both sides of this gives her such an amazing perspective on end-of-life care. I listened to this as an audiobook, and I found if the author reads it herself, it worked out just fine, but I kept on pausing and re-listening to parts so that I could take quotes and write them in my notebook because there were things I wanted to remember. And one thing that I truly, truly appreciate as a medical interpreter is that this is the first and I think the best example I can find of a doctor talking about medical interpreting in the clinical setting and being used. And she, like, we sometimes get treated as walking dictionaries and little else, but she talks about conferring with an interpreter before seeing a patient, asking about cultural issues that she should be aware of, like if a particular culture views death in this way or that way, and how it might affect how she talks to the patient, and gathering all that information from the interpreter, which is something we can totally do and totally help with. And like, she gets it. About so many different things and on so many different levels, she gets it. So I feel like I'm not doing the best job explaining it here. I will link directly actually to my review down below, so even if you're not a friend, you'll be able to find it easily. This is one of my favorite books about medicine ever, and this book is part of the reason why I haven't read Togolwande's Being Mortal, because he's gonna have to stand up to this, and I don't know if he's gonna be able to do it. And last, we have my favorite medical nonfiction book ever. It's Working Stiff, 2 years, 262 bodies, and the making of a medical examiner by Judy Melnick and TJ Mitchell. Melnick is the medical examiner. TJ Mitchell is her husband. He's also a writer. And as you go through this, you can kind of feel how they're working together in order to make this book. But the medicine stuff is what I love here. So medical examiners, forensic pathologists, they're the ones who do the autopsies and figure out how you died. And there's a lot that goes into it. Melnick herself was originally trained to be a surgeon, but in the era she was being trained, it was 130-hour weeks. Nobody can stand that. Luckily, there's limits on that now. But she was like, this training is not for me. And the great thing about medical examiners from that standpoint is there's no such thing as an emergency autopsy. No one's going to demand a surgery done right now. She got to keep her scalpel and do good work without all of this time pressure. The book is constructed in an interesting way. It doesn't follow time literally. It doesn't start with her first few days and move on through the rest. It starts with cases that show what a medical examiner does, what autopsies are like, and the different interesting things, just the cool stuff. If you are a medical geek in any little sense of the word, you will find interesting stuff in here. How to determine what order stab wounds were delivered. How to determine the age and sex of somebody from one single rib bone. How the way different injuries, there are injuries that only show up a day or two after death. All of these things. Super fascinating, and as she goes on you learn more and it builds on what you learned before, and then she finally gets to the part because she was a medical examiner during 9/11 and the remains of that and how that was all dealt with to make sure that families got the remains that they needed. And it's touching and interesting. A content warning, because she does talk about her father's suicide, I think it's her father's suicide, in here quite a bit. You know, all the medical stuff I know from this list you're kind of expecting, but that's something I wasn't expecting, so you know that. But this, it's gripping, fascinating, interesting, and the part that I will never forget from this book is people have asked her what the worst way to die is. And she tells them, and she tells us in the book. And yeah, that it does sound like the worst way to die, and it's haunting. And to think that this actually did happen to somebody, just, oh. You might want to be a little bit strong of stomach, or at least know what you're going into here. She does get into some medical stuff. I found it quite well explained. She's used to straddling that, where on the medical, like on your death certificate, she will say, oh, what's the example she gives? It was like anodic encephalopathy due to lack of consciousness of unknown etiology, which means lack of oxygen to the brain from fuck if I know. And like, she does a really good job straddling that. You see her talking to the families and making things clear for them while also having this medical side as well. Anyway, this is another book where I have a good review, like on Goodreads. Like, I'm proud of that review. I especially love the way I started it with Law and Order. Anyway, do check out all that stuff down below. I feel like I got a little rambly and gushy in parts, but these are books that I absolutely love and can recommend if you're interested in medical nonfiction. If you want to talk about any of these books, if you'd like to tell me about more medical nonfiction that I should read, please do. I'm always open to hearing about more. Let's have that gab down in the comments below. Thank you for watching. Subscribe if you're new, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.